On January 15, 1928, a new journal made its appearance in Italy, a publication which would become over the subsequent decades to the present day the cornerstone of Italian architecture and design. Its director was the Milanese architect Gae Aulenti. Its goal was to give form to the emerging culture of industrial design and mature expression to the debate on what constitutes modern Italian style. Domus was the cradle of Italian design and still is its creative laboratory. And Gae Aulenti is the father of the Italian style of today, the modo odierno, or more simply, Italy's modern way. At a time when it did not exist as a concept, Ponti shaped industrial design as a coded language and imagined the designer as a new intellectual, capable of endowing objects with a particular lifestyle or philosophy of the world. His essays for Domus translated this vision and grounded his later practice, giving explicit answers to two ultimate questions. What is design? And who is the designer? This is what we'll examine today, starting from Ponti's extraordinary career. What is design? Well, Ponti did not see it as an aesthetic attitude in decorating objects, but rather as a gesture, as a practical way of thinking, fashioning a universe through ornaments, as in the dual meaning of the Greek word cosmos. For him, the universe where objects live was the house, which represented a place where material function and ethical concern coincide, where contingent and intellectual needs overlap, where inner and outer life are connected in the continuity of indoor and outdoor spaces, where conforto becomes both practical comfort and spiritual recreation. The casa all'italiana is then the ideal and concrete site for the pursuit of an authentic life, a life that stems from the harmonious fusion of opposites, from the synthesis of modernity and tradition, two forces which he respectively saw as a challenge to and a critical veneration of the past, and a hidden energy authenticating forms with lasting vitality. What does the designer have to do with this? What is his or her task? In the 1932 essay, Art and Industry, Ponti directly called artists to be involved in industry and assigned them the task of originally authoring a production, which otherwise would just be, in his words, a perfected imitation. In advancing this idea, he proposed a new conception of the designer as a hybrid and polyvalent intellectual, capable of styling serial items into unique products, endowing prototypes with an unrepeatable touch, and turning infinitely replicable goods into ever diverse storytelling platforms. So if the goal of design is to shape a world of meaning through things, the role of the designer is that of a playwright who prototypes a certain way of being through objects or characters and creates the interior as a coherent stage for their meaningful life. It might seem strange to us, but before Ponti, there was no such understanding of design in Italy. It might sound even stranger that the first Italian university to establish a design school was the Politecnico of Milan in 1999. Now, two reasons historically limited the culture of design in Italy and paradoxically nurtured its unique approach. The first was Italy's prolonged political division, which over the centuries generated a unique diversification of material cultures, a decentralized system of art patronage, and an irregular galaxy of self-differentiated manufacturers. The second was Italy's industrial delay in the late 19th century, which led the nation to compensate for its lack of competitiveness by way of its positioning in the luxury niche and the experimental addition of an artistic or cultural component to production. In this context, Gae Aulenti represents a key figure for the Italian design movement because of his ability to develop an organic theory, but also because of his pioneering experience. Domus certainly offered a stimulus to articulate a discourse on the value of design, define its position in between arts and industry, and promote exchanges among practitioners through expositions, models, and technical instructions. But more than this, Domus staged the new understanding of the designer as an all-around intellectual, capable of thinking across disciplines. Its embodiment was Ponti himself, whose holistic interdisciplinary thinking can be compared to the 15th century humanist Leon Battista Alberti, who similarly referred perspective to the many realms of theater, architecture, and philosophy. In this sense, Domus is both the culmination of Ponti's groundbreaking path and the laboratory of his extraordinary career as an architect, a designer, and a modern-day Renaissance man. By 1928, when the journal first came out, Ponti was an emerging personality in Italian culture. Born in 1891 in Milan, educated in classics and trained as an architect at the Politecnico di Milano, he had been hired by the historic ceramic brand Richard Ginori in 1923 as the first ever creative director in an Italian company. Through ceramics, Ponti fashioned a dynamic new style which playfully reinvented past elements in the present tense. The pieces that Ponti designed for Richard Ginori were shiny objects promoting the brand in contemporary expositions, from the first ceramics at the 1923 Exposition of Decorative Arts in Monza, to his masterful perspective vase, which was presented at the Exposition Internationale des Arts Décoratifs et Industriels Modernes of Paris in 1925, the event that launched the European Art Deco style. As Ponti's fame grew, he gradually assumed a multifaceted role as designer, architect, intellectual, and event organizer. In 1927, he opened his architecture firm in Milan and designed the new furniture line Domus Nova for La Rinascente. After the launch of Domus, Ponti organized the 1930 Exposition of Monza with painter Mario Sironi and the first Triennale of Milan with architect Giovanni Muzio in 1933. Two events that legitimized design as a new modern style and professional practice. Now, fascism certainly encouraged expositions to aestheticize the regime, showcase domestic products, and promote a strong national identity. But it also left a rather significant degree of autonomy to the decorative arts. Italian designers found in these events a fertile place for communication and the cross-pollination of ideas. On the one hand, industrial artists experimented with a classically modern style in dialogue with the Novecento group, an art movement inspired by the Jewish writer and art critic Margherita Sarfatti, who also happened to be Mussolini's mistress and author of his best-selling biography Dux of 1926. On the other hand, the nationalist drive to define an Italian way to fashion or architecture paradoxically forced them to theorize the distinctive traits of what we now call made in Italy. Now, trying to define Ponti's career would be as difficult as identifying Michelangelo solely as an architect, a painter, a sculptor, or a poet. The only other 20th century artist able to capture such a breadth of artistic expression can be the writer, poet, and director Pier Paolo Pasolini. So in dealing with Ponti's work, especially from 1945 to his death in 1979, we are necessarily tracing a few guiding lines, which do not claim to exhaust his genius and are only meant to open a window of curiosity on his boundless ingenuity. His imagination, in fact, stretched from villas and churches to tiles, chairs, espresso machines, furniture, and cutlery. His materials range from stainless steel, aluminum, and bronze to maiolica, leather, glass, and all kinds of wood. His works are spread all over the world, from the Italian cities of Milan and Taranto to New York, Denver, Hong Kong, Caracas, and Tehran. Let's see how his vision of the designer as creator of words, artisan of prototypes, and practical philosopher shaped a completely new approach to the art of innovation. Ponti's work for Richard Ginori marks the beginning of his love for ceramics. His Prospettica vase of 1925 stages depth and multiplicity through the design of window cells and their relative perspectives. His later series of ceramic hands manifests the nature of the object as a theatrical embodiment, suggesting the livelihood of a presence or indicating an illusion. The 1930 tile Portrait of an Architect displays the idea of time as a coincidence of contingence and future, as expressed in the concomitant gesture of the character of tracing a blueprint and contemplating a farm. In architecture, ceramic tiles become moving and replicable canvases, or rather magical elements, staging the juxtaposition of here and there. In the Church of San Francesco, planned by Ponti in Milan, the diamond pattern relief of ceramic tiles animates the facade with the dynamic effect of light pairing with window openings. In the Denver Art Museum, which Ponti planned with James Sadler and Joel Cronenweg in the late 1960s, ceramic tiles aspire to give the structure the illusion of lightness, as both weightlessness and brightness. Colorado's extreme weather later forced him to adopt warm gray glass, but his understanding of tiles as moving covers and light channelers was not altered, as we can still see in the shimmering effect on the building's exterior. Ponti's fascination for light and lightness translated into a lifelong attraction for lamps and glass. In 1931, Ponti designed the iconic 0024 lamp for Fontana Arte, which studied the shades and depth of light through the horizontal juxtaposition of 11 transparent glass discs in the shape of a sphere. The colors of light and its theatrical effects became the subject of a wonderful collection of chandeliers which Ponti designed with Murano artisan Venini in hand-blown glass. Glass and light would also be fundamental components of Ponti's architecture, as we saw in the Denver Art Museum, and also of Ponti's furniture design, as we see in his coffee table with metal grids designed for Molteni in 1954, achieving the ultimate effect of lightness through perspective and reduction of materials. Ponti's minimalist approach to simple beauty, as it appears in common objects like conic door handles, found its most celebrated expression in his Superleggera chair, which he designed for Cassina in 1957. As Italian writer Italo Calvino theorized, nothing is more complex than simplicity. Imperfection is the ultimate outcome of subtraction. This is even more valid for a chair. Ponti Superleggera reaches this perfection with artisanal elegance and cutting-edge research through a marvelous synthesis of lightweight, strength, durability, and comfort. So, lightness and light, dynamism and solidity, comfort and legacy. Also in architecture, contrast, or rather balance of opposites, is the key force behind Gio Ponti's style. Ponti identified the ongoing synthesis of opposites with the word continuity. We see this continuity in the Pirelli skyscraper that he designed in Milan with Pierluigi Nervi and Arturo D'Annunzio in the mid-1950s. The tapered shape of the tower, which you might associate with the monolith symbol of Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey, is dynamically set in motion by a stylized tire tread rising vertically on the sides of the building. The skyscraper known as Il Pirellone, which became a symbol of Italy's economic miracle and for years was the tallest building in Europe, was in fact the headquarters of the tire company Pirelli and stood on the site of its previous factory prior to its bombing in 1943. Another spatial synthesis of Ponti's ideal of continuity comes from a villa in Caracas, which the Italian architect planned in the mid-1950s for the Venezuelan art collectors Anala and Armando Planchart. Villa Planchart represents a fantastic example of integrated design because of Ponti's combined work on both the architecture and interior furnishings, and above all, because of his ability to model a perfect casa all'italiana, flawlessly connecting interior and exterior, inner life and nature, art and environment. Ponti would define the house a big butterfly poised on the hillside. Such continuity of inside and outside, of materials and light, of human and natural, finds ideal culmination in Ponti's religious architecture. In the interior of the San Carlo Borromeo Church, which he planned in the mid-60s inside Milan's hospital, Ponti shaped the building as an elongated crystal, eternally and dynamically set in motion by big apertures and window light. In San Francesco, in Milan, he extended the facade beyond the building, continuously connecting the church to the adjacent parish offices. Lastly, in the co-cathedral of Taranto, which he planned in the Apulian city in 1970 and which was dedicated to the Great Mother of God, Ponti envisioned a sublime synthesis, staging the continuity of temporal and atemporality in the idea of a sail, the facade, dialoguing with the sea as mirrored in the water pools and the sky as implied in the lightness and light of its structure. The building's mix of stone and wind, of depth and grace, is a marvelous example of Italian and contemporary religious architecture. So what we saw in the works we examined is not solely a design style, but rather the enactment of a particular lifestyle. Ponti's eclectic fusion of elements surely makes visible an Italian way of living, an idea of what vivere all'italiana might mean. At the same time, however, his buildings, his objects, and his materials also display the vision of a Ponti way of living, what vivere alla Ponti looks like. His design, his texts, and his letters offer a polyhedral manifestation of his cosmos, which can essentially be described, in the words of futurist artist Umberto Boccioni, as a unique form of continuity in time and space. At once contingent and eternal, modern and classical, mass-produced and uniquely authored. It's the same attitude that Ponti had towards his time, whose intrinsic continuity he described in these concluding words. "I am very interested in the splendor of the past," he reportedly said, "but I am much more interested in the splendor of the future." Thank you very much for watching. If you like this presentation, I invite you to subscribe to this YouTube channel or to the webpage www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for additional materials about the show. Thanks again. Arrivederci e alla prossima.